Did you know that only 41 Fortune 500 CEOs are women? There is no question that women are significantly underrepresented amongst top executives. Lisa Su, the CEO of AMD, however, is proof that women CEO can perform just as well as men, if not better. Since Lisa took over in October of 2014, AMD stock has exploded 3,700%. That's equivalent to an annualized return of 68% per year. Considering this phenomenal performance, I don't think you'd be surprised to hear that Lisa was paid $58.5 million in 2019, which makes her the highest paid non-founder female executive in the world. So here's how Lisa Su became the CEO of AMD and subsequently became the number one paid woman in the world. Taking a look back, Lisa Su was born on November 7th, 1969 in Taiwan. I don't think Lisa has too much memory of her time in Taiwan though, as her parents would immigrate to the US when Lisa was just 3 years old. Lisa's dad was a retired statistician, and her mom was an accountant, so they both placed a heavy emphasis on math since Lisa was very young. By the time Lisa was 10 years old, she found herself taking apart remote control cars and putting them back together. When Lisa reached middle school, her family bought an Apple II computer, so Lisa was one of the first people in the world to own a computer. Anyway, Lisa ended up graduating from Bronx High School of Science in 1986, and she would move over to MIT that fall. At first, Lisa didn't declare a major, as she was unsure if she wanted to major in electrical engineering or computer science. Lisa was never able to come to a logical conclusion, so she ended up going with electrical engineering simply because it seemed like the more challenging major. While majoring in electrical engineering, Lisa worked as an undergraduate research assistant who worked on manufacturing test silicon wafers. Ironically, she's doing the exact same thing 35 years later. But Lisa still had a long road before she would jump into the workforce. Right after she completed her bachelor's, Lisa would turn around and get her master's from MIT as well in 1991. And after that, Lisa turned around and attended MIT once again to get her PhD in electrical engineering in 1994. So Lisa spent 8 years at MIT securing degree after degree. Fun fact, there's only 5 Fortune 500 tech CEOs who have a PhD, and Lisa is one of them. Moving on from her rigorous academic career, Lisa got her first job in June of 1994 at Texas Instruments. She only worked here for 8 months though, as she would switch to IBM in February of 1995. At IBM, Lisa worked as the Vice President of Semiconductor Research and Development, where she would break down one of the biggest barriers in the semiconductor industry. At the time, semiconductor manufacturers were unable to produce chips without copper impurities. Lisa figured out a brilliant workaround for this issue. Instead of using aluminum wiring to connect the millions of transistors in a chip, she opted to use copper wiring. This substantially reduced the impact of the copper impurities and made the chips 20% faster overnight. IBM would release these new copper wire chips in 1998, and these would become the industry standard shortly after. I think it should also be noted that copper was not even Lisa's specialty. Lisa says she worked on solving the copper issue because it seemed like the biggest problem at the time. So imagine if Lisa worked on something that was her specialty. After this massive contribution, Lisa would be promoted to technical assistant to IBM CEO in 2000. She worked in this role for about a year before she became the director of emerging products. According to Lisa, she was given basically full freedom within this sector. She was the only person within the sector, and she was free to hire whoever she wanted and work on whatever she thought was most important. Lisa hired 10 engineers and focused on low power and broadband semiconductors. The first product that emerged from this research was a microprocessor that improved the battery life of mobile devices. This won her the title of top innovator under 35 in 2001. In the following years, IBM would partner with Sony and Toshiba, which gave Lisa the opportunity to work with Ken Kutaragi. Ken is a Japanese engineer and former CEO of Sony, who is credited with improving the performance of gaming processors by a factor of 1,000. Despite working with such talented individuals, Lisa would shine once again, as her team would develop a 9-processor chip, which would later be used in the PS3. Moving on, Lisa would leave IBM in 2007 and join Freescale Semiconductor as CTO. She led the company's research and development effort for 1 year. But I think her more significant role at Freescale was actually on the business side of things. In September of 2008, Lisa took on the role of Senior Vice President. For the first time, Lisa shifted away from full-on research and development to a more business role. She overlooked global strategy, marketing, and engineering at Freescale, and was credited with, quote, helping Freescale get its house in order. After her time at Freescale, Lisa finally joined AMD in January of 2012 as Senior Vice President. Lisa's choice to join AMD was actually quite a peculiar move within the semiconductor industry at the time. Nowadays, AMD is viewed as the booming semiconductor company that is on track to beat Intel and maybe even Nvidia. But back in 2012, AMD was on the brink of bankruptcy, and the company was basically a penny stock. AMD stock stood at less than $2 per share, and the entire company wasn't even worth $2 billion. So it was odd that Lisa chose to switch from giants like IBM and Freescale to AMD. But as we know about Lisa, she often likes to do things just for the challenge, and joining AMD was no different. As higher level executives fled the dying company in droves, it wasn't too difficult for Lisa to move up the ranks and quickly become CEO in October of 2014. And this is when her real work started. When Lisa took over, AMD was losing $1 billion per year. So Lisa's first order of business was cutting the losers. According to Lisa, one of the most important decisions when running a tech company is not what the company should do, but rather what the company should not do. Lisa says that within the tech industry, you have to be number one or number two, or it's simply not worth competing in that sector. So Lisa went ahead and slashed many of AMD's business ventures, including chips and sensors for smartphones. Instead, she focused almost the entirety of AMD's resources on high-performance CPUs and GPUs. While this may seem like a super risky bet, as this limited AMD to two avenues of success, there was no way around this. Here's the thing, within the semiconductor industry, it takes 3 to 5 years to develop a new product. So when you're developing a new chip or graphics card, you're not competing to beat what's on the market right now. You're competing to beat what will be on the market 3 to 5 years from now. And with how fast technology moves forward, this is extremely difficult. So going all in on a few sectors was AMD's best bet for success. Aside from cutting the losers and going all in on CPUs and GPUs, Lisa also ditched the TikTok model. One of the factors that make the semiconductor industry so difficult is that they have to achieve precision and accuracy on an unprecedented scale. Today, basically every chip we use has billions of transistors. And you have to get each and every transistor on each and every chip correct. Even if a single transistor doesn't work, you'll be left with a permanently open or closed circuit, and a chip will no longer work. Given the insane engineering complexity of each chip, chip companies use something called the TikTok model. These companies alternate between improving the manufacturing process and improving the chip itself. This way, if you have a bunch of dead chips, you can easily identify the culprit. AMD, however, did not have the time to be playing around with the TikTok model. So Lisa just threw the industry standard out the window and figured that they can just do tick and talk at the same time. Being the brainiac that she is, Dr. Su actually succeeded in this overly ambitious plan that industry leaders initially laughed at. Moving on, Lisa's third order of business was offering unbeatable value. If you want to become number one, you have to make your product a no-brainer in terms of value and performance. And that's exactly what Lisa did with Ryzen. Just take a look at some of the flagship consumer products of Intel and AMD today. The Intel i9-11900K and the Ryzen 9-5900X both come in at $610. The Intel chip has 8 cores and 16 threads, while the AMD chip has 12 cores and 24 threads. Off the bat, AMD's offering boasts 50% more cores and threads. But this lead just gets even worse when you take a look at the base speeds of either chip. The base clock speed of the i9 is 3.5 GHz, while the base clock speed of the Ryzen 9 is 3.7 GHz. So not only does the Ryzen have more cores, but each core is slightly faster. If we multiply the number of threads by the clock speed, we'll see that the Intel chip can handle 56 GHz. Meanwhile, the AMD chip can handle 88.8 GHz. When both of these chips are the same price, going with the AMD option is a no-brainer. Now, there are some gamers who still prefer Intel due to their higher single-core performance, but in terms of multi-core performance, there's no comparison to Ryzen. And this has allowed AMD to beat Intel in the desktop market for the first time in 15 years. AMD is still catching up in terms of the entire CPU market, but I think it's just a matter of time until they overtake Intel in this category as well. And that brings us into the last opportunity that Lisa leveraged, which was Intel's complacency. Lisa handled the CPU and GPU segments of AMD almost identically, and both sectors have improved exponentially since she took over. However, the outcomes in both sectors are quite different. In the CPU market, AMD is on track to overtake Intel. In the GPU market though, while AMD has become a much more favorable option for consumers, Nvidia is still the undisputed king of GPUs. And the key reason for this is because Nvidia also has a stellar CEO, Jensen Huang, who's chugging forward as fast as ever before. The same cannot be said about Intel, and this allowed Lisa to stage a comeback for AMD. So, what's the secret behind Lisa's success? Well, in most cases, I think raw intelligence is overrated when it comes to business success. Usually, the bigger reasons are great timing, brilliant execution, great customer relations, or perfect marketing. With Lisa Su, on the other hand, I think if anything, her intelligence is underrated. She successfully ditched the TikTok model that the chip industry was dependent on for decades. She brought unparalleled price to performance to the computer market. And she completed all of these previously unthinkable engineering feats within a matter of years with a dying company. Lisa literally engineered AMD out of bankruptcy. Honestly, I don't think CEO is the right title for Lisa. I think she's more of a chief engineer who also just happens to make business decisions. And considering all of this, I think Lisa may just be the most intellectually talented CEO in the world. Do you guys think another CEO is smarter than Lisa? Comment that down below. Also, drop a like if you think women CEOs are underrated. And of course, consider joining our Discord community to suggest future video ideas, and consider subscribing to see more questions logically answered. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.